Hey everybody, it's Rudy Basso, the co-owner of Don't Split the Podcast Network. I would like to encourage you, lovely listener, to head on over to our website and give a listen to my show that I host with my brother called Game O'Clock. It is a video game retrospective, introspective, other spectives, all about the kind of games that we love. And to be honest, we love just about every game out there. Game O'Clock released every Thursday. It's fun, it's short, and hey, you'll probably learn something about video games.
This is Tabletop Babble. I'm James Intricasso. This week on the show, I'm talking with Jason Nelson of Legendary Games about Forest Adventures, and I'm talking with Mike Shea about Short Adventures. Both of them are running Kickstarters about the topic, and we will get more into that, into those conversations. Let's jump in right now with Jason Nelson of Legendary Games and see what we can learn about running games in a forest campaign. All right, everybody, now I'm here with the legendary Jason Nelson. Jason, welcome to Tabletop Babble. It's awesome to have you here.
Thanks a lot, James. Great to be on here again.
So let's talk a little bit about you and who you are, just in case our listeners don't know who you are in the world of tabletop games. And if they don't, shame on them. But tell us who you are and what you do in the world of tabletop RPGs.
Well, my name is Jason Nelson, as you said, and I run Legendary Games. I've been a freelance game designer for about 15 years. I've worked with Paizo and Wizards of the Coast in the past on a lot of different projects. For the last 5 years, I've been running Legendary Games, independent third-party company that produces stuff for both Pathfinder and 5th Edition. My main game of choice these days is Pathfinder, and I've authored or co-authored almost 70 products for Paizo, as well as Legendary Games. I think we're up to almost 400 products now. We do things from simple, you know, short PDFs to, you know, 300 and some odd page books. We've got, you know, probably a 700 page, you know, giant mega adventure path coming out later this year in Legendary Planet. We started out as a bunch of guys who were kind of regular Paizo freelancers and thought, okay, let's make stuff to enhance the Paizo adventure paths. And because we were writing a lot of those adventures and thought, hey, we've got extra ideas for stuff that would make them even better. And so, you know, me and a number of guys got together and created Legendary Games. Clark Peterson of Necromancer Games helped us get organized. And originally it was me, Neil Spicer, Quentin Boomer, and Greg Vaughn. And we've since expanded the team with more both industry veterans and some exciting up-and-coming young talents. And we started off doing kind of horror-themed products and then Far Eastern products. We branched out into what we're going to be talking about today, a more sort of, you know, forest and wilderness exploration and kind of kingdom-building products. We've done all kinds of stuff. It's really been a great ride. I've been doing this, you know, full time now for a couple of years, which is not that easy to do in the game business. But it's, you know, this has become my full time work, and I get to work with great people, artists and authors and talented folks all over the world, which is really a fun thing. But for me, we love telling great stories. We love just creating products that are beautiful to look at as well as they are fun to play and, you know, intricately and very well designed. There's a marketplace for all kinds of things in the role-playing game space, and some are more bare bones and some are more elaborate. We decided early on that we wanted to go with a product that looked great as well as played great, and so that's the direction we've gone with Legendary, and we create the product that we want to create, but ones that we think people will be excited about, and that's my approach. It's always be awesome, man.
That is amazing. And I have to say, 5 years, you have really done some amazing stuff. Legendary Planet, if people don't know about it, is a like sword and planet adventure path for both Pathfinder and for 5th Edition that people can check out. It is really awesome. I contributed to that Kickstarter. Trail of the Apprentice is sort of your all ages, right? Families can play together. Again, Pathfinder and 5th Edition. Legend D&D, which is amazing. And you've put out all kinds of other products since then. Legendary is high quality, works with the best in the biz. So I'm super excited to have you here today. We are going to be talking about a subject that relates to your latest Kickstarter, the Forest Kingdom Campaign Compendium for 5th Edition and for Pathfinder. All the advice you need to run a campaign that takes place in a foresty setting? Is that what I'm getting out of this?
Well, sure. And look, if you think back to the very beginnings of fantasy, you know, shoot, Grimm's fairy tales, Hansel and Gretel go off into the forest. You know, where are the monsters? The monsters, they live off in the deep, dark, scary woods. And you think about even, say, let's look at Lord of the Rings, and you have a number of forests that the heroes encounter along the way, and each of them is unique and different. You know, heroes are escaping from the Shire, and they go into the Old Forest. Now, there aren't any monsters that live in the Old Forest, but the trees and the land itself is magical and dangerous. So you've got that kind of a magical forest. Then, of course, you've got Mirkwood Forest, where parts of the forest are magical. Mostly, it's just full of monsters and terrible, vicious, evil things. Then you've got Lothlorien, which is, you know, a good fairy forest where everything is magic and wonder and amazing and beautiful. You've got Fangorn Forest, where, again, it's just incredibly old and dank and sort of almost prehistoric. And then even you have some of the minor forests. You know, the armies of Rohan are trying to sneak into Minas Tirith. They go through the Druidan Forest, where you've got these old sort of cavemen who live there who help them sneak through and avoid the armies. It's sort of neutral and not a mystical place, but a place where still danger happens. And Tolkien, you know, really brings out a lot of different flavor and experience. And you can play with woodlands and that kind of exploration adventure in a lot of different ways. And you go back to the beginning of, you know, D&D, things like Into Search of the Unknown or Keep on the Borderlands. You had to go through the woods to get to the dungeon. And as you expanded out the scope of the campaign, that was a natural place for adventure. And that's been, you know, played out in innumerable fantasy worlds. And so it's a classic fantasy trope. So like I said, we've done stuff like Legendary Planet, which is a sci-fi fantasy mashup. We also have co-published the new Ethera campaign setting with Encounter Table Publishing, which is, again, a sci-fi fantasy mashup, though with also with more flavors of horror and kind of a techno-magical noir. And that's great, and there's definitely is a market for those kinds of games that are a little more experimental. But there also is a hunger for classic gaming experiences, and there is nothing more classic in RPGs and in fantasy stories than the idea of the mysterious woods, whether it's a den of monsters or a magical sort of fae fairy wonderland. And you'll find both of those kind of things covered in a book like the Forest Kingdom Campaign Compendium. And our first Kickstarter, just to dial back, you know, about 4 years, was for the Gothic Campaign Kickstarter. Our first products were these horror-themed games, and that was another genre that we had seen kind of untapped. So we created a 256-page hardback compendium of all the horror products we had made at that point. Did really well. People were very happy about it. And we've even thought at that time, hey, we've got a lot of other sort of themed genre products. We want to create compilations for those as well. But we always sort of had more we wanted to do. And other products kind of came along and pushed the back burner, pushed the back burner. But this year, we have actually a number of these sorts of themed campaign companions we'll be doing farther later on. I think we have one for Egyptians-themed games, one for pirate-themed games and nautical campaigns, one that's for sort of Far Eastern games and sort of Asian influence. And again, we'll be doing these for Pathfinder and for 5th edition. But to come back to the one that we're doing right now, and the Kickstarter is ongoing, it's doing great. We're over 300% funded. And already it's going on about another 2.5 weeks. It ends on April 24th, the Forest Kingdom Campaign Compendium. And it's all about that. It's got forest-themed monsters. It's got forest-themed magic items and spells. It's got character options for archetypes and bloodlines and all that sort of thing. It's got two complete adventures. It's got ready-made characters. And it also has a lot of sections about playing with the tropes of the woodlands, especially dealing with the fae and fairy influence on the mortal world. Because I think we sometimes do a disservice to creatures like the fae when we just treat them as short elves with butterfly wings. And I think that it really is to the benefit if you make that idea of the fairy realm, something that is weird, something that is surreal, something that can really warp and alter what the world is like. And so we've got a lot of rules in that for really incorporating that feeling of the Fae as something different and alien and strange, natural, but sort of hypernatural. But also playing up the kingdom side of it for exploration, for sort of getting out there. This is a classic trope back from your first edition D&D. You get to a certain status, you get out there and you forge your own domain. You go out and found your own kingdom. And there are rules in that. We're playing off the ones that are, you know, were created for Pathfinder, for the original, for the Kingmaker Adventure Path, and from Ultimate Campaign. We've, you know, created them also for 5th edition, and we've expanded them with our huge successful one, the Ultimate Rulership, Ultimate Battle, Ultimate War, and Ultimate Factions now, and more of those to come. But it's about getting out there and building yourself up in some way that makes your character be something more interesting than just a wandering murder hobo kicking in doors and stealing monsters' treasure. You're becoming famous. You are becoming a person of some importance in the campaign world. And so there is stuff in here about building up your campaign, hosting royal tournaments and jousts and festivals, but not just kind of your classic archery contests. Yes, those also, but also the kinds of challenges for people and classes all across the board, whether they're magical classes, skilled characters. There's lots of different kind of fun things you can do to really make yourself someone, you know, of consequence in the world. And so the book is going to, it's approaching 300 pages or so, and it's got just a huge swath of interesting, fun, and cool themed options to really play on those kinds of classic fantasy tropes, classic fairy tales, and that idea of exploring and conquering the wilderness and building a domain of your own.
Let's talk then a little bit about this, because I have, when it comes to running forest adventures, and even, it sounds like whole campaigns, right, set in the forest, because this is a campaign guide, I have trouble sometimes as a DM, because I'm like, there's not a... Where's the dungeon? You know what I mean? Like, a dungeon crawl, for me, is easy to design because you have the sort of the walls. You have kind of these rails that you can keep players on. You know that they're probably not going to leave the walls of the dungeon. The forest, I think, sometimes as we, as dungeon masters, get a little overwhelmed, right? Because it's like, wow, there's this huge forest, right? You could go anywhere. And how do I make the story still have purpose, still have it make sense, still give the characters a goal that they can get to? How do you design a forest adventure when you are approaching something like that, particularly if it takes place like in the wilderness of the forest?
Well, you need to give the characters some reason to go there. And if you think back to the early 1980s, you know, with the so-called, you know, Beckmead series, the basic D&D took, you know, the first to third level, and it was focused dungeon. How you got to the dungeon, you didn't really think about it too hard. Then after that, they followed up with the expert rules, which then took you out into the wilderness, sort of expanding the horizons of what your character might do. And then they went from there, like the companion rules, right, mass combat and that sort of thing. But anyway, point being, it is an additional level of scope, because you have to tolerate at least a little bit of possibility that characters might not stay on the trail. To go back to the Lord of the Rings, hey, you've got, you know, Bilbo and the dwarves, they're walking through Mirkwood Forest, but at some point, they step off the trail. And there's some adventure along the way to get there, but the adventure takes a very dark and different turn once they go into the dark parts of Mirkwood. And it's the same kind of thing. In a forest campaign, you need to give them a lure, a goal of something that they need to get from here to there. But you need to have at least something built in for the branching possibility that they won't go where you expect them to. And so, much as if you're trying to, you know, create a stream of water that's going to go in a straight channel, that's fine. But if the water spills over, you need to have some ways to divert it back where you want it to go. And so, you do need to build in some contingency plans, more than you would need to in a dungeon. Because, shoot, you know, players are unpredictable, and they will find funny ways to get off track. But that's the first and most important thing, is to have something that is meaningful and interesting to the characters. So in the case of this Forest Kingdom campaign, there are two adventures already in the book. So one is called Cold Mountain, and one is called Horns of the Hunted. So Horns of the Hunted, I'll take that one first, is for 6th level characters, and it presupposes that your characters already have sort of established a bit of their kingdom, and all was their help, holding a celebration, a festival, and all of a sudden all hell breaks loose. these unicorns come charging in there, being chased by hunters who capture one of the unicorns and run off with it. So now you could, of course, not take the bait and not do the adventure. If you do that, all right, well, you move on to do something else. If you take the bait, then it becomes a long chase scene, which eventually you're following through. There's some traps left behind by these hunters who are fleeing. You eventually get drawn off into a little corner of the fairy realms where you finally bring them to ground before they can complete their nefarious plan with this captured unicorn. Okay? So you've given them a sudden event and you've given them a chance then to respond to it. You're playing on sort of their natural affection and interest. Oh, unicorns, those are good, right? So we should try to help them. And it also ties in some to the overarching meta plot of that sort of adventure path where in the past you found some dead unicorns. You know somebody's hunting them somewhere for some reason. And so you drop a big juicy piece of meat in front of them and then you drag it along and hope they follow it. So that's one kind of an adventure structure. Now, Cold Mountain plays more as a mystery. You aren't necessarily putting the juicy thing right in front of them as a lure. You're saying there is something going on and you don't know what it is. So instead of playing on their immediate reaction, their reflex, instead you're playing on their curiosity and their sense that there is some trouble somewhere and it's kind of just beyond the bounds of where you are. So you want to find out more about it. And if you're able to resolve that, you may be able to absorb more of what's there into your own personal wealth or into your own kingdom space. But there is something to go find out. And once you get there, then you start to unravel the narrative. And there are incidental things along the way. That's, I guess, a third point is if you're going to have a natural world, it needs to be populated. Now, back in the olden days of gaming, we used things like wandering monsters a lot. And that's not really so much in vogue. Adventure design is a lot more scripted now than it used to be. But it doesn't have to be. So if you're going to play in the natural world, I think it behooves you to have a certain sense of naturalism to it, which is that the forest is not divided up into the first level and the second level and the third level. You could be wandering through the woods at first level, and you might see a dragon or a shambling mount or something that will murder you if you actually go up and try to fight it. But that's part of realizing you're living in an open and dynamic world. Now, if you're having the killer monster chase them and wipe out the party just because, all right, that's dumb and that's bad GMing. But if you're placing that in their path and allowing them to react to it, it allows them to observe and experience this as a wider world and also to learn that, some battles are not worth fighting right now. So as you go along the way towards whatever the lore structures you've set up, I think having some window dressing and having some natural ambient existence of the living things in the world is important. And that also goes back to the idea I was talking about before of the influence of the fae realms. If you're going to play in the fairy forest, having not just creatures they meet, but strange happenings, so events that occur along the way. Now, some of that you can narrate along, talking about the weather, talking about the climate, and this is something you can use a specific system for, or you can just toss a few dice to decide if it's raining that day or not. That's how you just give some color to the world through which they're passing. That's more important out in nature than it is down in the dungeon where, it's four dungeon walls. It's kind of cold. It's kind of mucky. That's pretty much it. Out in the world, different parts of the forest will be different. And that sense of travel is important. And I'll say one more thing about The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit in particular, something that The Lord of the Rings movies did very well, and I think The Hobbit movies did poorly, was that sense of an epic journey. The time in The Hobbit was so compressed. It was the first Hobbit movie was not too bad. The second and third ones, though, look, it looks like Mirkwood, something they walked across in about a day. And so that sense of that epic journey, that we're actually going somewhere. If the monster doesn't live just down the road in the forest, but you actually have to traverse it, you get immersed in it. That's part of the point of having a forest campaign, is that sense of being in the wild. And the Lord of the Rings movies, I think, do a beautiful job of really setting up that sense of we are really going out into some wild and desolate places where people don't usually go. And I think that's a feeling that you really want to cultivate and that really enhance any kind of a wilderness campaign.
I love the idea of coming across a dragon that maybe you're not ready to fight yet, and making that clear to the players so that they don't think like, oh, I can kill everything I see, right? You're not playing Skyrim. Everything doesn't generate leveled for you to fight. I love that as a way to also seed things for later, like, okay, well, once we raise our army and we're lords of a village and, you know, we've got a lot of resources at our beck and call, we're coming back here and we're taking this dragon out, right?
Exactly.
Or a chance to maybe over the course of time, go back to the different locations and maybe make like a metallic dragon an ally. But cultivating that relationship so it's not just a, hey, we're here, you're good, we're good, let's work together. You know, it's the dragons are slow to trust. And so you can sort of, in downtime between adventures, have this side thing going on. I love all of that about wilderness. And I love the way you're describing the forest. It's not just, hey, that's where the elves live, right? It's a dark place full of lots of mystery and things like that. So when you were talking about Cold Mountain and you mentioned a mystery, the idea of a mystery in a forest is even more frightening to me because I'm like, oh no, what if my players pick up on an accidental red herring and all of a sudden they're going west when I want them to go east? That's where the thing that they need to face is. How do you handle that? Does Cold Mountain have a way to do that? Is it as simple as like, well, they don't know that that thing's in the east, so I'll just move it over to the west and that's fine, you know, or is there another solution for that?
Well, I'll say you just hit on one of the classic GMing tricks is that only you know where the railroad tracks are. So they don't know if they made the right decision or not. So events can always happen at the speed of plot. So you can always move things to be where they need to be. But again, that sense of a naturalistic environment that the characters are existing in, and they have to move from place to place. So the fact that things happen while the PCs are not there is important. And so as the characters, so in Cold Mountain, you find out about this, you know, terrible mysterious happening, these strange murders or killings out in the barbarian villages. They're superstitious. They don't know for sure what's going on. They've decided to come into the towns to ask for help. So you get out there, and what eventually unravels is kind of in part a ghost story, but in part also a story that deals with the idea that the Fae think about things differently. Because what the nut of the adventure is you have a hostile and powerful Fae, someone that the characters realistically can't fight, who has unleashed a vengeance on the barbarian villages because of something that she is interpreting the wrong way that the villagers have done. You know, a human villager has died. The villager who has died has created a ghost from her anguish. The ghost has possessed essentially the Fae's boyfriend. The Fae has come down and is mad because now the other Fae boyfriend is not recognizing her, decides obviously the villagers are at fault. So there's the whole sort of a, I don't know if you say mistaken identity, but there's a confusion between each side not really understanding what the other side wants and both being angry about it. And so the characters have to sort of engage in some conversation and some thinking about how do we resolve this and how can we bring these people together to have that conversation. And then even after you're able to make that connection and go up the mountain to talk to the Fae goddess, as she styles herself, there's still a problem because, well, she says, I kind of let the cat out of the bag and this curse is out running wild. I can't get it back and I can't leave my mountain to go get it. So here's the clues you'll need. So sorry. But then the heroes have, in several stages, they get to the barbarian village, they have to unravel the mystery there. Once they get here, they have to deal with the Fae. Once they deal with that, then they have to deal with the monster and the curse and its after effects. So setting up an adventure that happens in stages or in layers that kind of helps show that passage of time is something that helps that sense of a natural environment that is living and breathing. And again, you can do that in a dungeon. But a dungeon is also kind of a sterile black box if you want it to be. What happens in the dungeon stays in the dungeon. But in a situation where you've got, you know, people and nature and weather and animals and plants and the kind of the living, breathing organism and ecosystem that is the forest, that kind of adventure I think is greatly enriched by having that sense of layering and structure in the adventure so that, as you say, you can visit the same place more than once, and things will continue to evolve and happen even while you're doing the adventure. So I think that's an important strategy, is to really think about, you know, how to keep things moving in parallel to what the player characters are doing.
So how do you track those events then as a GM? You know, what do we do? Like, I love the idea of, hey, you know, the world didn't stop just because you took 3 months to sail to a cave, or just because you went to the other side of the forest, and it didn't mean that this side of the forest, everything was on pause until you came back. You know, we experienced new seasons. We suffered the consequences of you not being here to protect us, whatever it is. How do you track that stuff then as a GM? Because it feels like, especially when the characters are going to be such big influences in the world, it could get overwhelming, you know?
It depends on how OCD you want to be. I mean, certainly you can't set up a strict day-by-day tracker. So if the characters take, you know, here's what's going to happen. And this is something that's been done, you know, even way back in, one of the favorite examples was, if you go back to first edition D&D, there's an adventure called The Assassin's Knot. And it was set for the world of Greyhawk. And in that, it had a strict day-by-day layout of when things would happen with the assassin's plot. So, like, on day 4, this happens. On day 7, this happens. On day 10, this happens. And so the characters could take as much time as they wanted, but it gave you a very specific script for how long it would take for the, you know, the bad guys to enact their plot. And so that was sort of going on continuously in the background, and there were different clues the PCs might find when they went to certain locations, depending on where they were in that time span, because they might meet, you know, one of the NPCs before they've, you know, encountered the assassins. And so if they meet them before, they don't know anything. If they meet them after a certain point, suddenly they have clues they can share. And so it was structured in a very rigid kind of a linear way. So you absolutely can do that if you want to plot it out in very specific terms. You can also, like I said, sort of hand wave it. It happens at the speed of plot. In Cold Mountain, there is, you know, one of the town elders whom you meet the first time you come to town, and he's sympathetic. And then at some point, he helps the PCs ingratiate themselves with the other townsfolk. They go through sort of a ritual challenge. The PCs go off and, you know, move on to the next phase of the adventure. Meanwhile, this NPC goes off to the other villages to go and try and raise up support. Now, whenever the PCs get back later on and they've triumphed and they've killed the monster, they discover that this town leader has come back, but during that time, he's also picked up the curse. So he starts turning into a monster as well, and he doesn't know it at the time. But all of a sudden, you know, all hell breaks loose again when they found out they had killed the monster, but they hadn't quite extinguished the curse. And what are they going to do now that it's happening again? How will they resolve it? And there are different paths that you can, you know, use to. You could just kill the guy. You could try to, you know, cure him. However you approach it, we don't really care exactly how many days it takes him to go to these other villages. It's just when the PCs come back, he comes back the next day too. So yeah, you can hand wave it, and that's often easiest. It's more of sort of an event-based flowchart structure instead of a time-based flowchart structure. But time-based can be an entertaining way to go. Entertaining because, you know, only the GM really knows the whole story, because you can set up whatever's going to happen in the world based on how long it takes. An old second edition campaign I ran for a long time, this ancient evil empire had risen again, and things were happening on a certain timer. So the player characters went on with their adventures. Meanwhile, the bad guys were continuing to do what they did. And as it turned out, the player characters ended up taking almost a year of game time before they got back around to the evil empire plot, by which time they had actually rebuilt most of their strength, and the bad guys won temporarily.
Oh, nice.
Because the heroes, they weren't making mistakes. They were just choosing to adventure. They wanted to adventure. And the world kept on turning, you know, while they did that.
Yeah, yeah. And that's great. I feel like we talk about that a lot as GMs, you know, but you hear few people actually saying, like, oh, I did that. You know, they ignored this, and that was a big problem. And I made it very clear that if they ignored that, it was going to become a problem later on. And, you know, like, I love that you actually went ahead and did that. And I love that that's the idea behind this forest campaign, that you're not just having adventures in the forest, that you are a living, breathing part of the forest, and you have a real effect on the things that happen there. So what are some good, you know, foresty tropes, I think, for people to keep in mind that might be part of the book that you're putting out? What are some great ways people can build a really cool forest atmosphere. Again, beyond like there's elves living in trees, what are some good tropes that you think people can pull upon?
One of them is just the idea of civilization versus the wilderness. And, you know, the forest is a great, you know, cipher for that because you've got a very obvious way. How do you clear the wilderness? You cut down the forest. And that's going to create conflict. Why are you cutting down the forest or burning down the forest? Well, then what creatures are there and things that can be hostile to you based on your actions, not just because they're evil? Most fey are not evil, but they could certainly be hostile and troublesome because they look at things very differently from the way that mortals do. When I ran the Kingmaker campaign, and one of the player characters, you know, got in a dalliance with some sort of aquatic fey and wanted to move back to town, you know, and have their baby born there in town. Now, the fey approach this in a very different kind of sense. Like, oh, I would rather have the child be dead. You can't take them out of the forest. That's insane. And we kind of role played that out. And at first, the players were like, wait, what the hell? What are you talking about? It's like, no. And they all explained it using, you know, crazy fey logic, crazy to the player characters. But they realized this is something very dangerous. If I want my child to not be spirited away and murdered by its own mother, you know, because of, you know, the way that I want to raise it as a civilized, you know, person versus she wants to raise it off in this hidden spring in the forest, how are we going to fix that? So getting to the idea of things that can be hostile without being evil. Are you encroaching on their habitat? Are you heroes out there questing for good, or are you just the latest people, you know, invading the forest realm? And whose land is this anyway? Shoot, even animals are important in the forest to give that sense of dynamic naturalism. And really, if you ever watch any nature shows can be great inspiration for gaming campaigns because stuff in nature is often so much weirder than we think it is. So getting to that idea of the conflict between civilization and nature, are you exploring? Are you investigating? Are you conquering? Are you expanding your domain? And can you live in harmony with nature or in conflict with nature? So that idea of being on the borderlands, even if a kingdom technically owns the forest, it's still a wild and unexplored frontier. And so if you're somebody who is going to be establishing some sort of a domain for yourself, making a name for yourself in the world, making a land for yourself, you're probably going to have to hack that out of the wilderness. And forest, in this sense, is almost a cipher for the wild places of the world, even if it's the hills and the sort of the prairies and the meadows beyond and the mountains. The forest is kind of that first wall where wilderness starts. And then beyond that forest, then you've got the mountain peaks and everything beyond it. But that's kind of your first encounter and your buffer zone. The farmlands end, the forest begins, and that's where you can make your transition from the lands of civilization to the lands of the wild. So that, I think, is the first and the biggest trope to play with when you're dealing with any kind of a forest campaign. The other is the idea of things that are unknown. The forest is dark. It's trackless. It's hard to find your way around. It's easy to get lost. So it's a place that you are exploring. There's a sense of we are making our way into a place where other people don't go, or these other civilized people don't go. So we are having to blaze a trail. We're trying to find a path. We're trying to get something that is lost, which may once have been known, but has since become overgrown and reclaimed by the forest. It could be a lost city that, you know, fell in a war 100, 200, 300 years ago, and the forest has now consumed it. And so you get into the forest, and you still see the bones of that civilization, the castle covered in moss and trees sprouting up out of it, where civilization thought it would make, you know, its stand, but nature has once again consumed it. So there's that sense of things that are lost. So I think that's another great forest trope. The other is the idea of the natural versus the magical. And this is a lot of where the fey come in. Because what are the fey? The fey are natural, but they're hyper-natural. They are emotional, but they are hyper-emotional. They are basically everything about the raw, natural essence of people and things, but dialed up to 11 and colored in super bright day-glow colors. And they see everything so incredibly vividly, and they experience things vividly. We have a whole section there about role-playing the fey and how you give them a sense of that raw strangeness and surrealness and kind of dialed up to 11-ness that make them, like you said, not just elves with butterfly wings. And I think that's an important factor, is the force, the place of kind of magic and mystery, where you might step into something and all of a sudden you go from My Forest Down the Street to Alice in Wonderland. So I think playing with that fuzzy border between the natural and the magical, and this goes back to Tolkien too, places like Lothlorien or the Old Forest or Mirkwood, where it's very easy to get lost, to become enchanted by the glamour of the forest, and to get sort of drawn in and trapped. The forest is a place which is, it can be beautiful, but it also can be inherently hostile and dangerous, just the raw nature of the land itself, and not just the people that are there, but that the trees and the forest is an organism all its own, and that it sort of bleeds over from the natural world into the supernatural world. So I'd say those are your three key forest tropes: that buffer borderland of nature versus civilization, the idea of it being trackless and lost, and the idea that it's a place where the natural bleeds into the supernatural. And then, of course, there's just trees are beautiful and cool, and there are so many variations of what you could do with a forest, from swamps to hills to mountains and rivers and waterfalls. You're playing with a broad panoply of nature as a canvas, and so you can set up some very beautiful situations, but also things that are fun and dynamic game mechanically, is you can include almost any kind of a terrain and tactical setup for a situation.
For sure. Yeah, that is definitely true. You can have some really, really awesome, interesting encounters in the forest. And speaking of that, let's talk a little bit about creatures, right? We know sort of where to look for the obvious thing. Fae, plant creatures, green dragons, that sort of thing. What maybe special varieties of creatures are in this book that we haven't seen? And what are some forest creatures that you just really love?
I've always loved green dragons, so I just got to throw that out there because they're great. And I, as a kid, the idea of breathing out chlorine gas just seems so wicked and vicious. And it's like, that's much cooler than breathing fire to me. So,
yeah, definitely.
That's got to be my number one favorite. But in terms of creatures, like in the book, obviously we play a lot with the fae tropes. And the fae go a couple of different ways. And again, to go back, yeah, some fae are just these cute little elfin creatures, like, you know, brownies and sprites and pixies and leprechauns and that sort of thing. But fae have a lot of different aspects. You've also got fae creatures who are the more unseelie, the more vicious, the sinister aspect. So still beautiful, but terrible. But you also have an idea of fae being things that are, again, surreal and strange and misshapen, almost what in like Pathfinder category terms you'd call an aberration, or I think in 5e you probably call it a monstrosity. Things that are just so odd, they're kind of almost look human at first, but they've got, you know, 16 eyes popping out in strange places. Very much a kind of a Pan's Labyrinth or Hellboy 2 kind of a, that Guillermo del Toro visual style of the fae as the weird. So that's certainly another aspect of it. But then I think it's also a great place for fairy tale kinds of monsters, Lewis Carroll style monsters, the Jubjub Bird and the Jabberwock and the Frumious Bandersnatch, the Will-o'-the-Wisp, and a lot of these kind of folkloric fairy tale creatures, things with a Celtic or a Germanic or a Slavic kind of feeling, you know, are things that work very well. We've got a number of brand new monsters in here that, you know, are unique creations of Legendary Games, and we play a lot with that folklore. Some of this is drawn, you know, a lot of it is drawn from real world folklore. So you've got, you know, the Nake, which is really a different variation on, you know, the Nixie, the Jenny Greenteeth, the Nock. You know, they're different names for it depending on where you go in Northern Europe. But a specific and interesting take on the idea of the seductive river fae who kind of brings you in. Or you also have the Votenjack, who is the riverman who can take you anywhere on the river, but he can also strike a magical bargain where he can grant you favors, but he could also steal your soul, which he then stores on a little teacup in an island on a sandbar in the middle of the river somewhere. And if you find his store of magical teacups, then you actually can get your soul back. And he could also drink your soul down and grant himself magical powers by doing it. And these are things that are, you know, pulled from mythology and folklore in that European sense. We also pull some from some more like North American mythology. It depends on the flavor of the forest kind of campaign that you want. There's a lot of different elements to go for there. what are you thinking when you say forest? I think in classic fantasy, the forest ideal is much more of a Germanic, Scandinavian, and maybe to a certain extent, you know, Russian sort of feel when we think about the visuals of the fantasy forest. But certainly there are forest creatures from around the world. And I think this book focuses mostly on the European kind of forest tradition. But as we go on some of the stretch goals, there will be opportunities to bring in some other flavors of the forest into the campaign.
What are some of those other flavors as well? Love to hear about that, because we should mention at the time of recording, you're already well over 300% funded. So if people check out the Kickstarter, which is super easy to do, it's linked over at don'tsplitthepodcastnetwork.com, or you can search for Legendary Games on Kickstarter, and this will come up. So congratulations are in order. But let's talk a little about the stretch goals, because you are smashing through them at the moment.
Yes. One of the most recent thing that we went through was the stretch goals based on royal tournaments and festivals and that sort of thing. And that was the most recent stretch goal we passed. And that's been a product I've had working on the back burner for literally years. And this is finally my kick in the pants to get it done. And it's very close to finished up. We already talked a little about that earlier. But we also, in addition to bringing out more things for the campaign, so we brought out more character options, archetypes, bloodlines, and that sort of thing for wilderness exploration. We also had, you know, brought in that thing about tournaments. Every 4,000, we also add more monsters to it, and it's a case where anybody who backs the Kickstarter has a chance to help pick which monsters go in the book. So we've been, you know, working on this. So that, you know, if you want specific things to come up, we're actually posting up the first set of polls, I think, today, that people will be able to dive in and say, hey, these are the ones I want, and you'll be able to vote, and we'll get to see, and whichever five from each batch get the most votes, those will go in the book. We may fill in others that we want to use to balance out the way that it all sets up, but there will be a ton of great options to add in your own flavors. So, in part, what ends up in the book depends on what the backers choose. So, I always think that's kind of a fun way to give people who are supporting the project a chance to put some, you know, skin in the game and really say, this is what I want to see from when it comes to forest monsters. So they'll have an opportunity to vote for. So far, it's mostly on the sort of benevolent fae and the malevolent fae thus far. The next batch is for misshapen monsters. They're going to choose some of those more truly monstrous kind of forest creatures. And then there are some more goals coming up which have not yet been revealed. But plants, animals, and, you know, North American, some alternative different kinds of non-European forest creatures are definitely on the menu for some of those future stretch goals, to see if people want to bring those in and have those be added to the book to really diversify that forest campaign experience. So I can't tell you exactly which ones are going to be in the book, because only the backers will know for sure.
That's excellent. That's really, really cool. I love to see a big variety of monsters. As a guy who is always DMing, I could always use something new and different and terrifying or interesting to put in front of my players to see how they interact with it or how they decide to try to kill it, which is often their go-to, although not all the time, which is pretty good. So this has been great. What else should we say about the Kickstarter before we go, Jason?
Well, I would love for you to hop on board. It's been great. It's one of the things that is important to know is that almost everything for this is already written. So if this is not one of those Kickstarters, we're going to have to wait, you know, 6 months or a year or 2 years or whatever to get your stuff. Almost all the writing is done, even for the stretch goals. So we hope to be able to have this turn around within a month, and you'll start getting your stuff. Now, the route we use for the print solution will depend on exactly how many backers we end up with. Most likely we'll do it as individual. It will do a smaller amount of print books, but if we get a great response and we end up deciding to do a full-size print run, then, you know, obviously that'll take longer than doing a smaller scale one, just because of the logistics of getting it done. But, you know, like I said, within a month, everything should be laid out and ready to go. The bonus goal material will eventually be available as separate PDFs for those who want to get it after the fact. You know, because obviously not everybody wants to get the whole compilation. You really should. But hey, if you don't want to, that's fine. We'll also have the stretch goal material available separately, so you can go on and get that. There are special bonus goals. You can pledge to get a coat of arms created for yourself and included in the book. You can put a character into the tournaments and festivals section. You can pledge to collaborate on one of our future Kickstarters. So like I said, right now, this is the Forest Kingdom campaign Kickstarter, but we have coming up in fairly short order over the next year, we will have an Egyptian campaign compendium, we'll have a Demon Crusade campaign compendium, a Far East campaign compendium, and a Pirates campaign compendium.
Oh, and that's awesome.
If you want to look ahead and create some material to go in those, you can work with our designers on that. You can create your own royal portrait on this book, sponsoring artwork. You can create your own kingdom. You can sign up to become a member of the Royal Court of the Forest. Limited number of slots available, I think out of the original 12, six are left, where you can create your own kingdom, and you'll be in the book, and you give us the information there. It'll be all written up, so you can become part of it. You'll be listed by your royal title with a personalized copy of the premium copy of the hardback book. So there are special bonus goals you can also add on if you want our kingdom building and mass combat supplements, because those work really well with this Forest Kingdom campaign compendium. So again, you can add those on as PDFs or as additional hard copies if you want to get those in soft cover. People said, how come you're not including those in the book? Well, we still got more of those kingdom building and mass combat supplements to do, and we don't like to make a compilation until we're pretty sure we're done with a particular, you know, genre and product line. So we're kind of closing the book literally on the Forest Kingdom things. We've got a bunch of more of them coming out later on this year, so we certainly encourage you to keep your eyes open on the Legendary Games website, makeyourgamelegendary.com, and on great podcasts like this one to see what's coming up soon, because we will be having more of these. These are quick turnaround Kickstarters. We have big projects, we have smaller scale projects, and this one is one. The response has been great. We're very happy to get this together, and we hope people will check it out. It's really fun, whether you do Pathfinder 5th Edition or shoot both. There are people who have pledged and decided, hey, I want both of those. Or if you see something that you want to do as a pledge that you don't see on our list, send us a message to Kickstarter or email us at makeyourgamelegendary@gmail.com and say, hey, I'd like to do this and this. Look, we are all about finding a way to make it happen. So
that is awesome. Well, thank you so, so much. I really appreciate you coming on. People can find all the details, right, at makeyourgamelegendary.com. Is there any particular place they should look if they want to find you directly?
You can email me at makeyourgamelegendary@gmail.com. You can also hit us up on Facebook at Legendary Games, on Twitter at Legendary Games J, nice. On Google Plus as Legendary Games. So you can hit us on our social media or just straight by email. Any of those will get us where it needs to go.
Well, Jason Nelson, thank you so much for joining me on Tabletop Babble today.
Sure thing. Thanks a lot, James. Have a great one.
Hey, everybody. That was an awesome interview. I always have trouble when I am running Forest Adventures, so it was great to be able to talk with Jason about that. He's really got an interesting perspective. I really want to try that. And also outfitting your fort and everything, so cool. Anyway, I wanted to take a moment before we get to the interview with Mike Shea to let you know about this week's sponsor, Audible.com. Audible.com is offering a free trial to Tabletop Babble listeners for 30 days and a free audiobook of your choice. You know what I think you might like is Game of Thrones, A Song of Ice and Fire, Book 1. I actually listened to this on audiobook. It is amazing, it is gripping, and it is a great way to get over 30 hours of free audio read by the great Roy Dotrice. So definitely check that out, or any of the other titles that you can get for free on Audible. There's thousands of them at audibletrial.com/DSPN. That's audibletrial.com/DSPN for 30 days free. All right, let's get to my interview with Mike Shea about short adventures. All right, everybody, I'm here with the greatest man I know, Mike Shea. Mike, wow. Welcome.
You need to know more people. And you need to expand your horizons.
No, you fall into the greatest tier. I know it's impossible to have a superlative that encompasses more than one person, but you, Rudy Basso, my wife Bonnie, you all are the greatest.
You're the greatest too, James. love everything you do.
Oh, well, thank you. Right back at you, which is why I'm so excited to have you here. Mike, you are putting out a Kickstarter for Fantastic Adventures, which we are going to talk all about. But I'm hoping that you'll also talk with me about adventure design, specifically for like short one-shot adventures.
Sure.
and starter adventures, kind of. But tell me the idea behind the book. What is Fantastic Adventures?
Fantastic Adventures is a book of 10 short adventures written in a different style than GMs might be traditionally used to. They're not long-form, 10,000-word, heavy narrative adventures. They're short. They're focused on the very specific elements you need to run an adventure. They fit well into any fantasy campaign, but they're not set around any one particular campaign. I think I had already decided I was going to do it this way before, but I also ran that DM survey. And one of the things that came back from the DM survey, this is 6,600 DMs that I surveyed a few months ago. And it came back that 60% of DMs run their own campaigns. They don't run published campaign worlds or separate campaign worlds. They run their own campaign worlds. That's what many DMs want to do, is run their own campaign worlds. So I wanted to write something that fit into that idea. I didn't want to say like, okay, here's a new campaign world that you can run. That's you know, that you can go with. I wanted something that fits into whatever campaign they're playing in. So if they're playing a published hardback adventure, or if they're playing their own, or they're playing another campaign world, I wanted a set of small adventures that could fit into there. I wouldn't say that they're generic adventures, but they are adventures that will feel comfortable and will hopefully also be interesting and fantastic at the same time, but modular enough to be able to drop into someone's game.
And, you know, I should have led with this, actually, but what do you do? Like, tell the people out there, first of all, if you don't know Mike Shea, you probably have not been listening to this podcast. But, yeah, tell the people out there who you are and what you do as well, so they know that you're very serious. This is a man with years of game design experience, years of playing, thinking, writing, talking about D&D. So you know this is going to be a great product.
Yeah, I'm kind of an obsessive compulsive. I've, you know, been playing D&D since I was 14, so whatever number of years that is, like almost 30 years. And I've been pretty heavily involved in, you know, all of the things that surround D&D, adventure design, adventure development, writing for a blog, you know, writing, you know, DMing self-help books, all of that in about the past 9 years, pretty much since the beginning of the fourth edition of D&D. I have websites, slyflourish.com. I have a Twitter account called twitter.com/slyflourish, where I publish like a DM tip a day. And a couple of the things that I'm most known for, one is a book called The Lazy Dungeon Master, which is a book about how to make our games better while spending less time preparing at the same time. And I've done a bunch of freelance work for a bunch of different companies, including Wizards of the Coast, on an adventure such as Vault of the Dracolich. It's probably the most, you know, the most famous one, which is available up on the DM's Guild. Mm-hmm. So I've been writing all sorts of stuff like this. Last year, I wrote a book similar to this called Sly Flourish's Fantastic Locations. That was another successful Kickstarter. We were able to ship it out last year. I think we shipped the main book in the middle of the year and then shipped everything, all the stretch goals and everything, by the end of the year. And I wanted to kind of go one level deeper. I wanted to kind of scrape the onion one layer closer with Fantastic Adventures. So that's been kind of my obsession over the past year.
Which is amazing. So, and, you know, I hope it's okay for me to say I've been a little on the inside of the development process, got to play test.
Oh, yeah.
A Fantastic Adventure. I'm proud owner of Fantastic Locations. Got to read some of the material. So, you know, I am a super fan of yours. And I will say that you didn't mention this in your credentials, but your Critical Hits podcast is what sort of inspired me to start my own.
Yeah, that's a whole fun story where I'm like, yeah, you shouldn't do this podcast thing. That's a ridiculous idea. So I believe. And then you made a smart move and talked to Jeff Greiner. He's like, yeah, you should do it. And you're like, I'll do it.
And then years later, I would con you into making a podcast.
Right. Now, you're right. Only because you do all the work.
Right. That was my secret plan from the beginning. It would be like if somebody sort of went back and managed to get Firefly remade and put on the air. That was my secret plan, was get Mike Shea back into podcasting.
I always love doing podcasts. I just wouldn't want to manage one. Guys like you.
More than happy to make it come into existence. Because your head is just full of amazing ideas, and I feel like you've got this great way of thinking about things, especially when it comes to growing the game and teaching others to become dungeon masters, because that's really, you know, the game really needs dungeon masters to work. Mm-hmm. And so I feel like your blog is responsible for getting so many people out there, and now all of your amazing products and things like that. You just have one of the greatest advice websites out there, which is why I am so excited you've put out this book of adventures that are great for people who I think are veterans and want to have a book of a bunch of awesome adventures. But it's also great for people who are beginners. And you sort of mentioned Phandelver as a great adventure. You know, it comes with the Dungeons & Dragons starter set. Why do you think we need more Phandelvers? Isn't one Phandelver enough?
No, it is not. So there's a few things. One is that Wizards themselves has focused on larger hardback campaign adventures for the most part. I think the only one that they've put out now is the most recent Tales of the Yawning Portal, which is sort of a touch-up of their most famous classic adventures. So those are certainly separate adventures. But almost everything has been built around large campaigns. And I think even when we look at the Adventures League adventures and stuff like that, they're four-hour adventures, but they're big, too. They're 10,000 words, and they've got a lot going on in them. So I know that I personally wanted shorter, focused adventures that kind of left room open for me to let the game go where I wanted to go and didn't require a whole lot of me up front. Like, you know, I love getting these new hardback adventures, and I'll sit, you know, I took when Storm King's Thunder came out, I grabbed a copy and I went, and we were going off to a lake house for, you know, a few days, and I brought it with me and sat out in this beautiful lake and read that book like cover to cover, and then forgot it all and had to read it again. But I don't know that we all have time like that. And sometimes we just want to sit down and play some D&D, and sometimes we don't have a lot of time. So trying to fill that niche of smaller play sessions, I think, is important. And I think Phandelver does it really well. I love the four adventures in Phandelver. I think it's my favorite adventure that they've done. You know, it's straightforward. It's the right level range, you know, kind of a low level thing. It hits on all the D&D tropes. You know, it's got dragons and it's got all these dungeons and goblins and bandits that are hiding out in the old ruins and all this stuff. And the way that they broke that down into these sort of four chapters, you know, one based around each level, I think is a really smart approach. I definitely wanted to do more of that. I just don't think there's enough of them. There are definitely some good adventures that are up on the DM's Guild. One of the problems with the DM's Guild, though, is that, you know, people can't put a lot of money into developing those early because they don't know how much they're going to get. You've got probably one of the best, you know, you and Teos, right, have really kind of come out to say, here's what people can expect to get from products that they put out in the DM's Guild. And that can help, but you know, somebody has to kind of look at that and say, okay, so that's how much money I can expect to get on the DM's Guild. Am I willing to put that money up front for things like editing and art and design? And, you know, because that stuff is not cheap. To put an adventure up there like that, the general way people are going to go is, well, I'll take Microsoft Word and I'll write it up and I'll try to make it look as good as I can. And maybe I'll get some public domain art and I'll put some public domain art in it. And, you know, I'll have some friends of mine read it and, you know, I'll put it up there and I'll hope for the best. And some of those are not bad. I wish there were more that were of the quality of Phandelver, though, right? I wish that they had maps done by professional cartographers and brand new art done by artists who do this kind of stuff. And that's why I said, okay, so a book of 10 adventures funded through Kickstarter, you know, we can actually do that. I can actually make a book that hits that, you know, production goal, like where it costs $8,000 to put one of these together. With Kickstarter, we can actually do that.
You are 100% right about the Dungeon Masters Guild. And what's interesting is I think you're going to start seeing people like MT Black or Jeff Stevens, who have been putting out roughly, and in MT Black's case, a little bit faster than this, an adventure a month on the DM's Guild. They are now starting to take some of their earnings from that and putting them into other stuff to buy better art and to pay people to do layout and stuff. It's an interesting process that you'll hear more about on another Tabletop
Awesome.
Babble. Yeah, I think this is so great. And you know, experienced design is the other thing. I'd love to pick your brain about writing adventures like this, you know, because I think this is not an easy thing to do, to sit down, write an adventure. Even if you're just doing it for your home game, that is going to be interesting, is going to be a great one-shot, and is going to sort of tie all things up. Because there's a lot of times where I'm like, oh, you know, I can get a group of people together to play, and maybe they're new people that I want to teach the game to, but I know it's not going to be a regular thing. You know, I want them to have the experience of playing, so maybe they bring it to other people, right? How do I begin? Like, when you sit down, how do you begin writing one of these shorter adventures?
So that's a good question. And I think there's two different ways. And I think that they should probably, well, should, you know, listen to me. I always hate to kind of like give direct advice, like people should do X, because I don't know, people should try all sorts of different things and see what works. So it feels to me like there's two different kinds of adventures. There's adventures that you're going to publish, right? Where I'm going to sit down and I'm going to write something. And my expectation is I'm going to give it to you and you're going to go run it for a group. That's very different. And I think, you know, many people have said this too. That's very different than something that I'm going to write that I'm going to run at home. I used to kind of quip that, like, I don't design monsters for games because I'm not getting paid to do it, right? If I'm going to spend time making a new monster for a game, I'm going to reskin something. I'm going to do something quick and dirty. I'm not going to sit down and figure out exactly what someone's skills should be, you know, what some new monster skills should be. I'll do that if that's part of a published thing. I think that's true for adventures of both types. So do you want to hear about, I'll ask a clarifying question. Do you want to hear more about what the process is, or what process I follow for writing a published adventure, or what process I follow for doing a, like a home thing?
Well, I actually want to hear both. okay. So why don't we start with home adventure?
Okay.
Because I think that advice is going to be applicable to everybody. And then I think everybody fancies themselves they could be a professional designer. So we'll transition into that.
Yeah. And I think you're absolutely right. So for a home game, I have a very different process, and my home game, and you know, I'm sorry to plug again, but I'm going to plug my book, The Lazy Dungeon Master, because a lot of this comes from The Lazy Dungeon Master. I always try to start with, where is this game going to start? What's the initial hook? What scene? I always try to have like a fun scene that's going to occur, you know, some kind of interesting thing. Even if, you know, we ended at a certain spot, I'll kind of look at it and say, well, what if it didn't exactly start that way? What if it starts with a flashback or a montage? But ideally, something that gets the players rolling dice as fast as possible. So a lot of times I'll start in a fight, or I'll start with, you know, some kind of other important event that draws them in actively into the game. Then I'll usually have, like, what are the main beats of the adventure? What are the either what are the interesting locations that they're going to visit, or what kind of main scenes are going to go on? If there's a pretty big fork, then I might go down the path of deciding, like, okay, here's one fork or here's another fork, and what kind of elements should be there. But these are brief, so I usually only write down a couple of sentence fragments, you know, a couple of bullets. I usually don't write any more than maybe the equivalent of 2 3x5 cards worth of stuff for about a 3-hour game. If the games are longer, I might prepare a little bit more, but even then, the problem is they go off the rails so fast. So I usually don't write a lot. And my feeling is I don't know that we should write a lot, because if we're running the game, a lot of it's in our head. But we need a few things to write down that just kind of remind us what's going on. And then the other big one, which is kind of new and something that I've been thinking a lot more about and refining a lot more, is the idea of secrets and clues, which is just like, I try to sit anywhere I happen to be and say, what are the 10 interesting things that the characters are going to learn or could potentially learn the next game? You know, and it could be a little spot of history. It could be something about a villain. It could be, you know, anything, something they learn about a magic item they've got. So, you know, anything that kind of ties them into the main overarching story, anything that tells them something interesting about that they might not have known. And I don't associate those to anything. So I don't say, like, they're going to do a skill check looking at a fresco on the wall and learn that the, you know, their war with the giants has been going on for 30,000 years. I'll just say there's been a war going on with the giants for 30,000 years. And then how they discover that is kind of organic at the game. So the other piece, which I'll often do, is if I'm looking at locations, and this is something I've spent, you know, like the last 2 years or 3 years really kind of digging into, is what makes a good location? Because a good location is a hard thing to improv. It's a hard thing to just sort of make up at the table. And for me, like, a good location is some kind of interesting, fantastic place. And then the three interesting characteristics of that place, you know, so it could be a giant skull that's got a cave in the center of it. And inside that skull is a rune circle and a hanging effigy above this rune circle. And I don't know, burning violet candles that are inside alcoves along the outer walls. And those are all things that you might, you know, mention to the players so they can kind of build an idea of why this place is interesting in their head. And it's also something they could potentially interact with. They'll go, what's up with those candles? And then you go, oh, I don't know, they're magical. And they're like, can I do something with them? Like, sure. But when I'm running a game at the table, I just jot those things down. I don't write like a big paragraph. I don't write flavor text for it or read aloud text. I just say, here's the feature, you know, Skull Cave. And then underneath I'll say, you know, violet candles and weird runed thing on the floor and hanging effigy. And then I'm done with that place. It's like seven words, right? And the nice thing about all that is if the game goes sideways and I throw that away, I didn't lose that much. I didn't write, you know, 500 words about that. I wrote like 8 words about it. And maybe that chamber will come back in some other form later, you know, or maybe they'll actually visit it some other time. But my investment is low. And that idea of having a low investment for preparation like this, I think can really make for a fun and organic game.
Do you save those 3x5 cards for like
random
stuff when they do go off the rails?
So I actually don't use 3x5 cards. I have like a little Moleskine notebook that's the equivalent. It's like a, you know, 3.5x5.5-inch notebook.
That's awesome.
And yeah, so those I preserve. And the nice thing is like they go back all the way through all the campaigns. So I have one notebook that I've been carrying around now, and it has like all of Curse of Strahd and all of, you know, it's Curse of Strahd for 2 different groups and Storm King Sunder for 2 different groups. And I can kind of go back and a lot of times, like, I missed my game last week, so I just still have the notes that I made for last week's game. Or they skip a place. I had one group where I wrote this whole sort of mini dungeon out that they were going to explore, and they ended up deciding not to go there. And I was like, okay, no problem. And then I kept that. And then later, like, hey, let's go back to that place. And then I was like, oh, cool. And I just flipped back a few pages and had all my notes for it. Yeah, so I like to preserve it like that. But the main thing is to try to make sure that they're not too rooted in stone. You know, nothing becomes real. Nothing becomes solidified until it gets described to the players. Sure. And once it's described to the players, now it's truth, right? Wow. And it has to stay truth. And you know, it can be twisted a little bit, but, you know, that's when it becomes solid. Otherwise, it's just ethereal, you know, it's just ethereal paste.
Which is good. That's a good way to approach things because then you're more willing to let go and sort of go with the flow, right? Which is always
right.
A good thing.
Yeah, I that's why I really feel like the less, you know, the less kind of effort we put into anything, we need just enough effort to kind of be able to run it and no more, because if we have too much, we're going to force it. You know, I joke, like I got a new mini, I got a miniature for Countess Sansuri. And it's gorgeous. It's this like, you know, 6-inch tall cloud giant sorceress type. And I'm like, well, that means she's not dying anytime soon. You know, like I'm not going to have that mini. I'm not going to have that mini on the table only once. And it might, you know, I told that to my wife, Michelle, and she's like, oh, great. You know, and I'm like, look, I paid $18 for that thing. I'm not going to like have it out there and she gets stun locked and killed. You know, like she's coming back. So
yeah,
that's exactly. It's that kind of thing, right? If you make a beautiful map or you set up a really big Dwarven Forge system, like, you know, it's like a gun in the first act. Like you're not going to put that out there and not have it get used.
Exactly. Yeah. So that sort of covers how you prepare for your home game.
Right.
And I'd love to, you know, I think when we have the time, like let's get into after this, you know, some encounter design stuff and talking about running those shorter adventures. But before we do that, let's talk about now the other side when you're designing it for somebody else to use in a professional published product.
Sure. So that largely depends on who I'm publishing it for and whatever kind of style guide that they use. I tend to follow the same sort of general model that I've used for a few years because it's one that to me feels like the pace kind of fits, although I worry that it becomes too stereotypical. It's like, you know, somebody can very easily say, oh, it's a Mike Shea adventure. We started with a fight. You know, I kind of use this same thing, which is, you know, again, what's that big starting hook, which draws the players into the game early. And then I tend to follow like a lot of NPC interaction and exploration up front. And then, you know, kind of the deeper exploration of like what, you know, going into a dungeon or exploring, you know, exploring deep places. And that could be a mixture of your typical sort of exploration and trap finding and discovery of clues along with combat encounters that can take place. And, you know, I kind of follow that same format. The format for the adventures in Fantastic Adventures are, you know, is kind of the one that I prefer. And I built them a lot around that same thing I was just describing. Like, where does the adventure start? What's the, you know, hook up front? So right off the bat, why do I even care about this? And then what's the summary of the adventure? Like, what's the general outline? How is this thing supposed to play out? And I, you know, that could be a little loose and it could say things like there could be 3 possible outcomes for this or whatever. So it's not meant to be too rigid. and then notable NPCs. Who are the main interesting NPCs that are going to come into play in this adventure? One difference that I have with these adventures than ones I typically write is then I have a secrets and clues section, very much like I was talking about before, which have a bunch of these bullet list secrets and clues, things that the characters can discover a number of different ways. The odd bit and one thing that, you know, will be a little bit demanding of the DM is that I don't assign them to a scene. So if you have a scene of exploration and interaction and going around to taverns and finding the drunk and shaking the drunk down to find out what he knows, I don't have scenes set up for that. My assumption is you'll read these secrets and clues, and then the GM will, as the players say, well, I don't know, maybe I should go explore. You know, maybe I should go. We should go take a look at those old caves that we heard about. And then you might say, okay, what secrets and clues did they discover at that cave? Or let's go talk to the Lord. Maybe the noble Lord knows more about what's been going on here. Who's been around this town long enough to be able to understand some of this old weird stuff that we've been hearing about? I have a customizing section. So like, how can somebody take one of these adventures and build it around their own campaign or twist it however they want? And it's usually just like which NPCs you can easily replace or what part of the plot can change or what background of the character might be a solid hook. And that's sort of the upfront material. And then it's like, okay, where's the game start? You know, what's sort of that central starting hook? How's it going to begin? And then I kind of jump right into the locations. What are the interesting locations that this adventure is going to focus around? And sometimes it's like rooms in a dungeon, and other times it's like, well, these are just general locations that people are going to go to. And for the Fantastic Adventures, it's usually about five or six of these. It's not a huge amount of them. It's not dozens and dozens of rooms. It's not the 130 rooms of, you know, Tomoachan. Each of those has read aloud text, because I'm a big fan of read aloud text. I find it, mm-hmm. I'm always happier when there's read aloud text. And agrees. I always figure, yeah, well, not everyone agrees, right? So I do a few things. One, you don't even have to read the read aloud text. If you just want to know what's going on at the place, I have a thing called area aspects, which is kind of like what I described before. What are the three interesting features of this location? So if you don't even want to read anything and you're like, okay, I'm looking at the sample, for example, it says the tangles. I can skip all this read aloud text about the path that leads up there. And I could go, okay, there's poisonous tangleweed, sinkholes, and statues of ancient lords. And then as a GM, I can describe all that stuff. I can say like, oh, okay, it's a poisonous tangleweed. Like, what's that like? So I try to make it easy for people to skip the read aloud text if they don't like it. If they do like it, I always prefer it. It is in there. And it's not long. It's not paragraph and paragraph and paragraph of 1700 years of history. It's, you know, tell us about the path. And it's usually about three to four sentences each for those read aloud sections. And then there's the, you know, each of those locations kind of says, here's something that goes on there. So like, what are the, you know, what are the skill checks that somebody has to follow in order to get through the tangle weeds, or you know, what happens, what monsters might be there, or anything else that's going on.
When you're writing a published adventure, you know, published adventures vary based on who's writing them. Sometimes they're very prescriptive, very quote unquote railroady, for lack of a better term. And sometimes they try to cover everything at the expense of not going in depth on anything. It sounds like you actually have this sort of different method of like, here's the likely path for the adventure. Here's what's happening. Here's the major players. Here's where they're going. And then here are the sections you'll need for improv. Is that right? Kind of right to say?
Yeah.
Which is great.
Yeah. I think that, I mean, adventure design is so hard, and I don't know, like, the idea that we're still experimenting with it, you know, 40 years after we started writing these things, I think that's telling. Like, the, you know, I don't know that there's really a right format for these, and railroading versus sandbox adventures, you know, like, I mean, again, looking at Storm King's Thunder, Storm King's Thunder is very sandboxy, you know, lots of different options, lots of different potential paths. And there's a whole chapter that's like 130 pages of just, here's, you know, 150 places you could potentially go. And that can also, like, I know as a, you know, pretty experienced GM, I was pretty overwhelmed by that section. And I think I took like four and said, okay, I'm going to use these four. And I don't know what it, you know, the rest of these are too much. So I don't know that anybody's found a perfect model. Two pieces of inspiration for me for this one. One was a book that Monty Cook put out for Numenera called Weird Discoveries, which is also like four-page adventures for Numenera. And I really liked his style for that. And the other one is Rob Schwab for Shadows of the Demon Lord, who puts out these really short, like 4 to 6 page small adventures that are really rich in feeling, but don't just overwhelm you with text. I think that there's a kind of an industry problem with the way published adventures work, which is that we're still paid by the word. And, you know, like if you're writing a 4-hour adventure for somebody, you can't say like, hey, I bet you I can do a 4-hour adventure in 3,000 words. You know, they're going to pay you for 10,000 words. And the expectation is you're going to have all 10,000 of those words, which means either your adventure is going to be really, really, really rich, like have lots of stuff, or you're going to override it, you know. And I'm accused of, you know, I'm not accused of both. I don't think anybody's accused me of that, but I know I'm guilty of both. You know, I know that I've had adventures where like I wrote the guy, I'm like, look, I finished it in 8. I don't know what you want. Like I could get into further depth, but it's done, you know? And I know that I've written some adventures that I probably think could take about 4 hours that were only a couple thousand words. You know, the Rat Warrens from one of the Kobo Press books recently, the Book of Lairs, was one that I had done. It's like a were-rat warren. And I think my word count for that was 2,000 words. And it was like, you know, you get into a were-rat dungeon and you crawl through the dungeon fighting a bunch of pain-in-the-ass were-rats. I don't know. I think there's so many different approaches that people can take. And you know, sandbox versus railroad is a big one, but also just, you know, what we write and how we write it is another big one. You know, should we have stat blocks in there? Should we not? You know, if you look at fourth edition with the way that they designed adventures then, where like every sort of encounter was this 2-page spread that showed a map and diagrams of what was going to go on and monster stat blocks right there and, you know, sort of turn by turn descriptions of what happened. And now it's kind of like, hey, there's a bunch of things in here, you know, let the players decide. I think we have a lot of cool minds that are on this problem, and we're going to see a lot of variants of it, you know. this is mine, right? I hope it works.
Sure. And I think part of that answer is what is right for the story, right? What's the proper way to go there for a story? And I think crafting these sort of one-shot adventures that you've created, which can also be played all together, right?
Yeah, they can. They all have like one central town and one central region. And actually the second to last stretch goal was to have Cecil Howe, who does cartography for Shadows of the Demon Lord, he's going to put together a overland map and a village map so that they can be tied together. I was very loose with it because I want to recognize that, like, I am perfectly happy if people say, yeah, that town is stupid and I'm not going to have a town. You know, I'm not going to use that town. I'm going to use my own town. I'm great. I'm perfectly happy with that. But just in case people say, you know what I want? I want to be able to just grab this whole book and run every adventure and have like a campaign out of it. Okay. I mean, it's not a lot of words, right? Because like the adventures are the bulk of the book. So the idea that they all generally take place around this town and there's a cast of NPCs that have a tendency of showing back up from adventure to adventure, one could run a whole campaign in this one place. I wouldn't even say that's the expectation. The expectation is that it's not going to be played that way, but one can do it.
Man, Cecil Howe is awesome. Friend of the show. If you haven't heard his interview, check it out.
That podcast is like, man, I gotta see if I can get that guy. And I emailed him. I think you helped me get in touch with him.
Yes.
And, you know, well, I told him what I wanted to do. And I, you know, I have seen his stuff in Shadows of the Demon Lord, you know, which is one of the best, I think it's like one of my favorite Kickstarters that I ever backed, just in certainly in sheer volume of material. And, but also in the quality, like it's just fantastic. And his art is great in that style. I stole a lot, or I didn't steal, but many of the artists that are doing fantastic location stuff are people that have done stuff for Schwab.
That's awesome.
For Shadows of the Demon Lord, because I just love that style. And it's not all so super gory, you know, people defecating themselves to death. It's, you know, mine's a little cleaner, but sure. That style is there. The cover, for example, Jack Kaiser, who does work for Shadows of the Demon Lord, did the cover of this and is doing a bunch of the internal art for this one.
Yeah,
and awesome. Just been outstanding. Yeah, and the art's really great.
Yeah, they really, really great artists on that product. So, it's awesome that you have them doing stuff for you now. So, let's then talk about encounter design.
Sure.
I face this problem sometimes that I have, I play in a game where maybe I've got 3 hours, right, to
yep.
play. And
yep.
and realistically, right, by the time everybody gets in and talks to each other, it's more like...
2.
Yeah, exactly. So, and then, you know, you talk about the 5-minute workday. When you've only got 2 hours, it's like, how do I get the story in that I want to tell, you know, have a nice balance of combat and exploration and interaction, and then also have these interesting combats that challenge my players, these interesting encounters. So what's your encounter design advice? Because I will also note that Mike Shea does not believe in the tyranny of the grid.
I do not believe in the tyranny of the grid. No. That is correct. And I still use it from time to time, but I'm finding more and more I'm starting to eat my own dog food and run with a grid less and less.
But that's good. And that's one of those things, you know, I think, again, if you can develop that tool, it helps you in other ways. For instance, like when you are 15 minutes away from the end of the night and you know somebody's got to get home for whatever reason, then you don't have to draw out the map for that final encounter. You can be like, all right, let's go. You know, it's right. great to have right. that tool in your toolbox. So how do we design great, fantastic, if you will, encounters, which I assume is going to be the third book in this series.
Fantastic encounters. Yeah. I don't, if it is, I haven't started thinking about that yet. So I don't think so. It's a catchy title and it would be a great third book on the shelf, but I don't think that's how it's going to work.
So
I think
it'll be fantastic.
This is as micro as I'm going to get.
We're not going to do like fantastic feats or fantastic aboleths.
Single words. Yeah. Just words. Just, here's 50,000 unique words. One of the things that I've been playing around with in my brain and kind of watching at the table, and certainly I think my feelings on the tyranny of the grid fall into this, is the idea that designing a combat encounter is no longer what I aim for. I aim for creating situations. And the situation could be you walk into a room and there's six angry bandits there, you know, or you could be, you know, walking across the frozen tundra and there's a you know that you're being tracked by a Remoraz under the ice. I'll create these situations, but I no longer presuppose that it's going to turn into a fight, because many times the players will come up with creative solutions around it. And sometimes that might even be counter to their own desires. Like they actually want to fight, but they're finding ways to not have a fight. And then you got to figure out, like, what do I do then? You know, like they're not having fun because they bypassed something that I expected they were going to do. I mean, not all the time. There's certainly times where I sit down and say, I have a full expectation that they're going to sit down and fight a couple of frost giants. Like, I don't know how this is going to go any other way. But many times I'll just create this sort of scene. And in the scene, there's actors, you know, there's NPCs that are doing stuff. Those NPCs might be, you know, were-rats. The NPC might be a dragon, you know, I don't know. And there might be, you know, again, I have a heavy focus on what are the interesting features of an area. And I've started to rely more and more on a random script that I wrote called the Ancient Monuments script. And it generates these sort of weird ass things that you'd find in a place. I just pulled it up now. And like, you know, the first one that comes up is the floating dark elven gravestone of blessings. You know, and I don't know what the hell that means. Obsidian goblinoid monolith of bloodshed. That one's a little better, right? So then you can kind of imagine that you're going through an old swamp and you see this huge monolith that's got all these like little goblin handprints all over it. And that just kind of on its own sort of invokes a sort of interesting situation. And then the fact that it's surrounded by, you know, bloodthirsty crocodiles. Now I've kind of got an image in my head of what's going on. And I'll just set that out there and I'll be like, you know, you're walking through the swamp and you see this weird ass, you know, obsidian goblinoid monolith with all these little bloody handprints on it. And then, you know, with the right perception checks, they'll notice the alligators, the bloodthirsty alligators that look like they're mutated somehow. And it's up to the players to decide how they're going to deal with that. And some might say, I fireball them. Right. And okay, now we're right into a combat encounter. But other times they might say, like, I don't know, is there a way for us to sneak around this? Can we get around? You know, what if, you know, how do we deal with it? And maybe the odds of them getting around are really poor because those alligators are smelling them, you know, but maybe there's some other way. Maybe one of them uses animal handling to, you know, kind of control the alligators, or they use bait to try to steer them away. And that all can kind of make an interesting scene. But I know that as a GM, I would be disappointed if I planned out a big combat fight against these awesome alligators and I sat down and made new stat blocks for, you know, blood-infused crocodiles. And then they don't get used because somebody figured out a way around it. So yeah, definitely more and more I've steered towards creating scenes and not so much creating combat encounters. Now, on the other hand, I often know that there's going to be a scene that's going to be a fight, and I just try to stack a few layers on top of it. And one of the layers is what are the fantastic features of this place, just physically. What does it look like? What's cool? You know, it's almost like story hooks. What are the physical hooks that exist inside this area? You know, the obsidian goblinoid monolith is an example, but then there's also swampy water and gripping vines and hanging tree limbs and other things that either could get in the way of the characters, or, you know, maybe even ways that they could do stuff. They're going to grab a vine and swing over those crocodiles like Pitfall. I don't know. But those physical hooks could be really good. Sometimes they'll throw like an overall environmental effect. Maybe there's like a fog that's rising and they can't see more than 10 feet in front of them, just to kind of change the encounter. You know, one nice thing about these D&D encounters is you can tweak about 5 different variables and have completely different battles than we've ever seen in our lives, even though we've been playing the same game for basically 40 years. So those are all things I have in mind. But again, I play them all loose because I want to be able to throw them away. And I don't want to get mad if I had this really great idea for like some sort of battle arena. I'm remembering they have these video games, the kind of third person shooter video games, where you'll go into an area and it's very clear, like the minute you walk in, like, oh, we're going to have a fight here. Mass Effect did this, you know, did this definitely. Mm-hmm. Gears of War is what I'm thinking of. The Basso brothers would be all over this. So, you know, like Gears of War. You know, I know that like I'd be running through a hall and I'd be talking to guys, and then I'd like turn a corner. I'm like, wow, there's a whole bunch of like things for me to hide behind. Like, why would I need? Oh, look, I'm in a fight. You know, and it's that same sort of thing. Like if people walk in, it's sort of like, you know, when you drop the gridded map on the board and stick out a bunch of minis that you've been hiding away in a plastic bag, they're not about to start talking to them. You know, they're not about to say like, you know what, I'm going to just turn around and leave. Like, I don't like it here. You know, they're going to accept, like, oh, I guess now, you know, checking their watch, you know, do we have 45 minutes? Because it's time for a fight. And, you know, many times that's fine. People probably love that. And that's fine. You know, it's not the wrong way to play. But I think that there's other ways of approaching it. Did I answer your question at all?
Yeah, no, that was huge, hugely helpful, I think. And that's, you know, I think it goes to show, just like we were saying about with adventures, there's no one formula to crack encounters. There's no one formula to crack published adventures either. And I have to say, what you're describing about, you know, I just put my players in situations and see where that goes. A lot of times when I am at your table, and I mean this as like the highest compliment possible, I feel like that scene in all of Quentin Tarantino's movies that are super duper tense, like before stuff goes down, and everybody's trying to read each other. And like, I'm so in the moment in that, because there's this feeling of you're being so organic with it that you're reading them too, right? Like sometimes a fight starts because somebody just says the wrong thing.
Right. Right.
That's awesome. It's great to know that, like, maybe there's a way out of this, and maybe Mike doesn't even know what it is, and we're going to find out together. I think it's great.
Yeah, I mean, and that, I definitely try to take that approach. Like, I want to be surprised. You know, I want to be surprised and delighted. I think Dungeon World, the RPG Dungeon World, you know, that taught me a lot. Like, I didn't even play it. I think I played it, like, 3 times, right? But I love it, and it's one of my favorite RPGs just because the way that it sort of shifted the perspective of what a DM does really resonated with me. And like, you know, it has that list of like 10 sort of principles of DMing. And one of them is play to be surprised, you know, play to see what happens is one of their other ones. And another one is be fans of the players, you know, be fans of the PCs. And those two, like right off the bat, like how, you know, God, I wish I'd heard that when I was 14. You know, like that totally would have changed how I played D&D. Like that idea of like, I want to be fans of the characters. I want to know their backgrounds, and I want to tie into those backgrounds, and I want to make them feel good. You know, I'm going to use skill checks and use lore. Be like, because you're a lizard man. When did lizard men become PC races? So, you know, because you're a lizard man, you know all about this weird tribe of the gleaming serpents. And you know, you've heard that. And then, you know, you see a glyph, but you get advantage on your check because you're a lizard man and you know about these swamp type folk. That's sort of like always kind of steering it around what the characters are and who they are and what they're about, I think is a really fun way to go. And I know I get like a lot of sort of a positive feedback loop when players feel like their character got a special thing because of who they are. That really, my overall enjoyment of the game goes up.
So, Mike, as we wind down here, let's talk just a little bit more about your Kickstarter. So the name of the product, and people should go onto Kickstarter right now, or they can head over to don'tsplitthepodcastnetwork.com and find the link in the show notes for this episode. It's already funded. So yeah. If you contribute, you're getting this book. But yep. You have a pretty cool option there for people who might have missed out on fantastic locations,
yep.
Right?
Yep, I do. Yeah. So that was, you know, the Kickstarter we had last year was really good. The product, I'm very proud of the product. But I know a lot of people didn't get in on it. And so there's an opportunity to get in and pick that up along with Fantastic Adventures together for, you know, significantly less than you'd pay for both PDFs separately. And they go together. So one thing I tried to do is I said, okay, I shouldn't pretend that these are two totally separate things. So every one of the adventures has hooks into one of the locations in Fantastic Locations, which is a little tricky because I want it to stand on its own. You shouldn't have to have both books. But I wanted to make sure that there was an option that if you say like, okay, I like this adventure and those five rooms are really cool, I sure wish I had 12 more. Well, guess what? You can pull up Fantastic Locations. There's a whole little section that says, you know, for this adventure, you know, it's just a tower, but you could use the old monastery, Fantastic Location. And then you've got 12 other additional rooms that are sitting there below that tower than just the one that you went into. And that gives the DM sort of a lot of opportunity to add other things in there, you know, extend it, you know. I think a lot of these adventures are like 4 hours at a long stretch, you know, 4 hours, a lot of banter, and probably could be abbreviated down to two. If somebody moves pretty quickly, but if somebody wants something even longer, then there's this option to sort of extend them. I always love this idea that like every old tower has like an infinite dungeon below it. You know, every one of them is Greyhawk and every one of them is Undermountain, and you could just keep digging and finding stuff. I mean, actually Fantastic Locations does that too, right? Fantastic Locations says here's 12 chambers, but there could be infinitely more. So this one is saying there's more, you know, there could be more chambers and you can find them in Fantastic Locations. So maybe the books will go the other one. It'll be like Fantastic Underworlds, and it will just be, you know, a 7,000-page book of mega dungeons.
Oh, that would be so great. I would love that.
That's not happening.
Well, everybody tweet at Sly Flourish, hashtag. Yeah,
that won't matter.
Sly Flourish is mega
dungeons. They can do that all the time. I don't bow to peer pressure. I'll tell you what, if somebody independently funds me for the rest of my life and gives me good health care, you know, I would be happy to just sit and write dungeons for the rest of my life.
We do have several billionaires who listen to this show.
That would be awesome. So, one of those billionaires, all I need is like $5 million. You just send $5 million to me, I'll write all the dungeons you want. Can't be bought.
Well, there you go. So send $5 million to Mike Shea. But if you don't have $5 million to give, but you do want to support him and get something awesome in return, the Kickstarter is Sly Flourish's Fantastic Adventures. Get in on it now. It is fully funded. Mike Shea delivers. It's all written already. It's all pretty much ready to go. And I have seen the product. It is amazing. And, you know, I don't know, Mike, are we allowed to hint at something I might be contributing to this?
Yeah, I was going to say, there's one whole section of this thing we haven't talked about that you and I have talked about a lot. And so probably ought to be a disclaimer in the beginning of this whole thing, which is, yes, I asked you and you graciously offered to help me with the final stretch goal. You were the very last stretch goal, not because it was the least, but because... To me, it's a really important one, and it's one I've really wanted to do for a long time. Again, Phandelver had these great characters. I think there were six characters for that one, two fighters and then one of everything else of the base classes. And they were character sheets that had levels 1 to 5 written on the character sheet. So you could theoretically go through all of Phandelver with this one pre-gen character and then upgrade it just by looking at the back and seeing what you got. And I like that design a lot. And I wanted to sort of dig into that a little more. One thing is I didn't like that you couldn't really customize those guys very much. I don't know if you could choose gender or not. I can't remember if gender was pre-decided or not.
I think gender you could choose for yourself.
Okay. Yeah. So I definitely wanted to have these be open gender. I wanted them to have open backgrounds and bonds so that people could kind of change their background and bond. But the recognition that like if you're going to play a fighter, you're going to play a fighter. Here's a fighter character sheet. And also make sure that these are designed to be able to level up throughout all of the adventures and Fantastic Adventures. And the idea is if you go to a gaming convention, you go to a shop or you go to a friend's house and you say, like, I want to do this, but I want to do this at level 4, you can just grab the sheet, look at the level four section, kind of circle it, update the sheet based on that, and you're ready to play in a very quick amount of time.
Yeah, so I've been thinking about these a lot. So, right, there will be one for every class.
All the classes that are available in the SRD.
Yes, yeah, all the classes available in the SRD. They'll obviously use those builds as well in the SRD. Right. So they're going to be sort of optimized, right? So that if you're a new player jumping into it and you're using a pre-gen, you're not playing like a halfling barbarian.
Yeah, there's no need to play the Gonzo character classes.
Exactly.
Yeah, Gonzo race class mix, because people can go do that. They can just make one.
Yeah, exactly. And then all of this obviously fluid at the moment, but one of the things I really like that we're doing is we're pulling out the flaws and the personality traits and the bonds and the ideals, and those are actually going to be separate things that your characters choose from at the beginning. So even if you're a new player, you're going to have sort of some say in the way your character acts and feels, even the way it's written down on the sheet. And I like that because it's going to allow us to tie those things into sort of this fantastic adventures setting and the various adventures that are being played, and also to the characters themselves, without having it be, you know, you have to take the wizard if you want a particular bond or that sort of thing. Because,
right,
you know, there could be a fighter who wants to pursue knowledge, or a wizard who carries around the axe that, you know, his grandfather used to slay a dragon, right?
Right,
So that's really fun.
Yeah, and the nice thing is all those backgrounds and bonds and everything are separate. So it's sort of like a separate page that gives you that stuff. So if you decide, like, I, this adventure is sitting in my own campaign world and I have my own set of stuff, they're blank, and people can add in any sort of background or bond that fits what campaign they're currently playing in, even if it's something different than what's in this one. Yeah, so you're doing the development of those, mm-hmm. and then Eric Nowak, who is doing who's done all the design for, I think, like the last four books that I've done, agreed to do the actual character sheet design. So we're gonna try a bunch of different variants of that. Like, you know, it's got to be functional, right? It's got to do what we want it to do, and got to be easy for people to be able to use, and people that are familiar with the current character sheet should be able to see this, but also kind of, you know, recapture that feeling that we're 9 years old playing D&D in our basements in 1988.
Totally. Well, I think it is going to do just that, and I'm super, super excited to see what you come up with next. So, Mike, where can people find you?
SlyFlourish.com and Twitter.com/SlyFlourish.
That's right. And if you want to hear more of Mike, check him out right here on the Don't Split the Podcast Network. He's on a great, great podcast called The DM's Deep Dive,
yep,
with Mike Shea.
We've got one in 2 days.
That's right. Yeah. So, in fact, as you're listening to this, if you want to check out the one we recorded on Thursday, you can go to our Twitch channel and watch it. And it'll also be available as a podcast and on YouTube later on, so check that out. And who's the guest, Mike?
The guest is David Hartledge. He writes the website DM David, and we're going to be talking about what we can learn from the 40-year history of D&D.
Yes, and DM David is another one of my favorite D&D websites.
Yeah, awesome. One of my favorite writers. One of my favorite writers of this hobby of ours. You know, he kind of popped up on the grid during the earliest days of 5th edition and D&D Next, and I fell in love with his work, and just really, really smart guy, really thinks deep about this stuff. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, I just love to have guests like that. I love to, you know, I want to talk to people that are as obsessed about this hobby as I am. It's my goal for that show.
Absolutely. So, and it is a great listen. So, Mike, thank you so much for coming on Tabletop Babble.
And it's been my pleasure, as always.
I love having Mike Shea on the show. He is just an amazing human being, a great friend, and a great designer. You know, Tabletop Babble is still a new show, and it really, really helps us if you can log onto iTunes and give us a 5-star review. Even if you don't listen to the show on iTunes, a lot of other podcatcher apps use the iTunes review algorithm to base the popularity of their podcast as well. And there's a lot of people listening on iTunes. So you can make an account. It takes like 30 seconds. You can go leave us an awesome review. It seriously, seriously helps us out and costs you maybe a minute of your time. Plus, I read one new 5-star review verbatim on the show. You can make me say anything you want. And someone has definitely taken that to heart this week. Their name is Scrub Kai. Scrub Kai has a review entitled, "This is the best RPG news and discussion podcast I have found." And the review reads, "Tabletop Babble is a dependable weekly podcast of news and advice on tabletop gaming. While he often focuses on D&D, I believe that he is me, he also covers other games and tangential topics. Even when I go into a topic thinking, this is something I think I will only be slightly interested in, the episode is always entertaining, informative, and makes me want to try something new out." That is awesome. "The podcast production quality is quite good, and James's moderating style is wonderful, letting his guests dwell on a topic without ever letting the discussion go stale. His guests are almost always interesting and informative, ranging from the biggest names of the role-playing game industry to motivated fans who are simply well-informed on the topic they are covering this week. In short, this is one of the few podcasts I always consume as it is published, and I recommend you try this one too. Plus, he reads some reviews on the podcast, so here you go, James." Oh boy, here it is. "When smart RPG insiders gather to talk tabletop gaming, they call it Tabletop Babble. And when James opens up the podcast to fans who are great enthusiasts but have no insider information, we call it Tabletop Rabble Babble. On weeks when the news is slow, James has to scramble and grab some new interesting topics. We call those weeks a Tabletop Rabble Grabble Babble Scrabble. Yet, even on those episodes, when into the other related topics they do dabble, the content is still interesting and enjoyable. We call those weeks a Tabletop Rabble Dabble Grabble Babble Scrabble. When into the real world they delve to find inspiration for our gaming, sometimes stories like Babble or creatures like the Wabble do they well. On those weeks we call the episode a Tabletop Rabble Dabble Grabble Wabble Babble Babble Scrabble. And when his discussions turns to disagreement, James moderates this well, preventing brabble while still letting his guests express differing views. But on the few times that does happen, we call that a Tabletop Rabble Dabble Brabble Grabble Wabble Babble Babble Scrabble." Whew, Scrub Kai, thank you so much for this review. I would love to see somebody go ahead and top this. Thank you so much. It has really been a pleasure to read all your reviews. I'm running out, and I'd love to continue the pleasure. So go ahead and leave us a 5-star review. All right, everybody, you can find me on Twitter at James and Chicasso and on my website, worldbuilderblog.me. Tabletop Babble is a show on the Don't Split the Podcast Network. Special thanks to Rudy Basso for founding it with me. Our theme music, which you're listening to right now, was provided by Battle Bards. Until next time, remember that RPGs are like sex. If everyone's having fun, you're doing it right.